Ducks are everywhere, on ponds and city parks, in country streams, and farmed for meat, eggs, and feathers around the world. But where did our domestic ducks actually come from? With chickens, the answer is fairly straightforward. They trace back to the red jungle fowl. Ducks, however, have a more complicated story. Instead of a single origin, there were two separate domestication events on two different continents from two very different wild ancestors. So how do these two lineages fit into the duck family tree? And what does that tell us about duck evolution, domestication, and even conservation today? If you'd like to learn more, check out the document in the description with research papers and image credits. Let's start by stepping back and looking at the wider group, the anseriforms, or waterfowl. Today, this order has three living families. Anemidae, the screamers, contain just three unusual South American birds. They are large, long-legged, and rather goose-like, but with spurs on their wings and bare patches of skin. They are named for their loud trumpeting calls, and in some areas have even been domesticated as guard animals. Next is Anserinatidae, with only a single living species, the magpie goose of northern Australia and New Guinea. This family is ancient, with relatives stretching back to the Cretaceous period. Magpie geese look somewhat similar to true geese and were an important food source for Aboriginal people. But the group you'll be most familiar with is the Anatidae, the ducks, geese, and swans. A few unusual lineages diverged early in their evolution, such as the whistling ducks, the spur-winged goose, the white-backed duck, and the freckled duck. The vast majority, however, fall into one of two subfamilies, the Anserinae, with the geese and swans, and the Anatinae, which includes most of the ducks. The Anatinae are a large and complex group, often divided into as many as seven different tribes. Their exact relationships are still poorly resolved. We don't have a clear picture of which tribes are most closely related. Today, though, we only need to focus on two, the Kirini, or Perching Ducks, and the Anatidae, the Dabbling Ducks. As their names suggest, their differences led to notably different lifestyles. Perching ducks tend to be more arboreal, with strong claws that allow them to roost in trees. They are also versatile feeders, grazing on land, browsing in trees, or dabbling in shallow water. By contrast, dabbling ducks specialise in that last behaviour, dabbling. This is a feeding style where they feed mainly at the surface of the water, tipping their bodies rather than diving. Of the two, let's start with the perching ducks. Today, this term is colloquial. It doesn't have a strict scientific definition. I am using it for the clade Kirini, but historically it was much broader. It used to be given to any duck that roosted in trees, under the assumption that they were all closely related. This is not the case, making it a paraphyletic group. While I am presenting Kirini with two genera, there are doubts about whether it is a valid grouping at all, and the genera might be better placed closer to other tribes. Kirina only has one species, the Muscovy duck, Kirina muscata. Muscovies are native to the New World, found throughout much of South and Central America, and north into Mexico. They have since been introduced to the United States, Central and Eastern Europe, Australia, and New Zealand. Large and striking, they are mostly black with prominent white patches on their wings. Their most distinctive feature is the pink mottling on the face, while males also display iridescent green patches and a large knob at the base of the beak. The origins of their common name are actually quite mysterious. Muscovy is an old name for the region of Russia around Moscow, but as these ducks have never lived there, it seems an odd choice. One suggestion is that the name comes from the Muscovy Company, an English trading company active in the 16th century. But even this explanation is unsatisfactory, as the company never traded with the Americas, so was unlikely to have much involvement with the trade of Muscovy ducks. Other theories exist, such as a link to the Muisca, a Native American culture in present-day Colombia. But in the end, the true origin of the name remains uncertain. Muscovy ducks are most closely related to the other genus in Kirini, Aix, which contains two species, the mandarin and the wood duck. These are renowned for the brightly coloured males. The mandarin duck is native to Eastern Asia, mostly China and Japan, while the wood duck occurs closer to the Muscovy's range, the United States, southern Canada, and northern Mexico. Now, let us move to the tribe Anatidae, which contains many genera. At least 7, with another 8 potentially included, though their exact placement remains disputed. Because of this uncertainty, we'll focus on the genus most relevant to our story, Anas. Anas has 31 species of ducks, teals, and pintails. It broadly forms two clades, with the 20 teals and pintails in one, and the 11 species of ducks in the other. Let's zoom to the end of the duck side of this family, as here is where we find the mallard species complex. At the centre of this group is the mallard, Anas platyrhynchos. It is closely related to 3 North American species. The American black duck, Anas rubripes, the mottled duck, Anas fulvigula, and the Mexican duck, Anas thearzi. These species are so closely related that their boundaries are blurred. They readily hybridize where their ranges overlap, producing fertile offspring that carry mixed genetic traits. This makes the mallard complex an intriguing challenge for taxonomists and conservationists alike, as it can be difficult to determine whether a particular individual belongs to one species or another. Contrast this with the muscovy. Muscovies and mallards can interbreed, but their offspring are infertile, hinting at their more distant relationship. The mallard itself has proven highly adaptable, spreading across much of the northern hemisphere and interbreeding with local wild populations. This adaptability, along with its close relatives' overlapping ranges, has created a web of genetic interactions that continue to shape duck evolution today. From this mallard complex came most of the world's domestic ducks. In East Asia, mallards were domesticated thousands of years ago, with archaeological evidence from China dating back at least 2,500 years. Farmers selected them for their eggs, meat, and feathers, eventually producing a wide variety of breeds. Some, like the Peking duck, are farmed on a commercial scale, while others, such as the call ducks or ornamental varieties, were bred for their appearance and behaviour. Yet, despite this diversity, domestic ducks remain genetically very close to their wild ancestors. They can still interbreed freely with wild mallards today, blurring the line between the farmyard and the wild. Archaeological evidence helps us place duck domestication in a wider context. Ducks were not the only waterfowl domesticated in China. Geese were too, and possibly even earlier than ducks. Bones of domestic geese appear in sites dating back more than 5,000 years, long before ducks became a regular feature of human settlements. The contrast is striking. Geese, with their flocking behaviour and loud calls, lent themselves well to early domestication, while ducks seem to have been taken up later, perhaps because they were less easy to manage in large numbers. This raises an interesting question. Why domesticate ducks at all when geese were already established? The answer may lie in their different ecological niches. Ducks could forage in rice paddies, shallow ponds, and marshes in ways that geese could not, complementing rather than competing with existing domestic birds. On the other side of the world, domestication took place independently. The muscovy duck was brought under human care in Central and South America long before European contact. Archaeological evidence suggests that the Moke people of Peru were raising muscovies around 2,000 years ago, although whether this is the first domestication event is uncertain. Muscovies were valued for their leaner, strongly flavoured meat, their quieter calls, and their ability to thrive without access to large bodies of water. When Europeans arrived, they quickly adopted them, spreading muscovies alongside mallard-derived ducks across the globe. Farmers also discovered that muscovies could be crossed with domestic mallards, producing so-called mule ducks. These hybrids combine traits of both parents and are widely farmed, but they are sterile, unable to reproduce on their own. Because of this, they do not occur naturally in the wild, existing only through human intervention. One of the most ingenious uses of ducks is in rice farming systems. For centuries, in parts of East and Southeast Asia, farmers have released ducks into flooded paddy fields. The birds feed on insects, snails, and weeds, reducing pests and helping control invasive plants, all while fertilizing the water with their droppings. In this way, ducks form part of a low-input, sustainable farming cycle that requires little chemical intervention. Even today, some traditional rice duck farming systems remain in use. Researchers have shown they can rival modern intensive methods in productivity, while being far less damaging to the environment. It is a reminder that domesticated ducks are not just sources of meat and eggs, but connect as partners in farming systems that stretch back generations. As trade and colonization expanded, ducks traveled with people to nearly every part of the world. Today, domestic ducks can be found on every continent except Antarctica, deeply embedded in both farmyard and food cultures. For millennia, ducks have been more than just a source of food. In China, ducks, including mallards, came to symbolize fidelity and marital happiness. Pairs of ducks appear in art, poetry, and household ornaments as emblems of harmony and enduring partnership. In Feng Shui, Mandarin ducks represent enduring love and marital fidelity, but mallards still hold an important place more generally within Chinese culture. Across the globe, ducks have become an important part of human cuisine, and this culinary value has in turn driven the diversification of domestic breeds. In Europe, duck features in dishes such as French confit de canard, British roast duck, and Venetian duck ragu. In East Asia, Peking duck and Cantonese roast duck are iconic, while in Southeast Asia, braised and spiced duck dishes are widespread. In Latin America, ducks are used in tamales, stews, and festive preparations. The demand for particular flavors, fat content, or size encouraged farmers to selectively breed ducks, producing varieties more desirable for the cuisine of the local area. For example, the Peking duck was selectively bred in China for rapid growth and tender, fatty meat ideal for roasting, while smaller, leaner breeds were preferred in stews in other regions. This reflects culinary refinement, showing how human food culture has shaped the evolution of domestic ducks alongside their natural adaptations. Beyond the table, ducks also became entwined with aristocratic hunting culture in Europe. Duck shooting evolved from a practical means of procuring food to a sport of prestige, with nobles organizing elaborate hunts to demonstrate wealth, skill, and social status. These hunts often involved specially managed wetlands, decoys, and trained dogs, highlighting both the economic and symbolic importance of ducks in medieval and early modern European society. Among the farming communities of Central and South America, the Muscovy duck held cultural significance through its practical value rather than mythological symbolism. Known for its quieter call, adaptability, and ease of rearing, it became a reliable source of meat and livelihood. While not prominent in legend, the Muscovy's role in sustaining daily life gave it a deeply rooted cultural importance. While not specifically the Muscovy, ducks also feature prominently in the mythologies and stories of many Native American cultures. In some traditions, they are seen as clever tricksters, using their wits to outsmart other animals or humans. These stories emphasize traits like adaptability, intelligence, and resourcefulness, qualities that reflect the duck's real-world behavior. In other tales, ducks symbolize abundance, fertility, or the connection between land and water, appearing in folk tales, ritual practices, and on pottery and textiles. In this way, ducks were valued not just as a food source, but as culturally significant animals, woven into daily life and spiritual imagination of these communities. In the modern world, ducks remain ever-present. They are companions in city parks and ponds, characters in children's stories, and even sporting mascots. At the same time, they are one of the most widely farmed birds, with breeds like the Peking duck forming the backbone of global duck production. In this way, ducks sit at a unique intersection of nature, culture, and human history, both familiar and yet surprisingly complex. While mallards are highly adaptable and common in urban areas, other duck species are less so and face significant conservation pressures. Habitat loss is a major threat worldwide. Wetlands are drained or degraded for agriculture, urban development, and water management, reducing areas available for breeding, feeding, and migration. Climate change adds another layer of pressure, altering wetland ecosystems and the timing of seasonal migrations. There have been some advancements in their protection in the modern era. Hunting was once a primary driver of population declines, but it is now largely regulated, with most countries having strict rules on seasons, species, and bag limits. This has helped many declining populations recover, although vulnerable species can still be impacted by illegal or unregulated harvests in some regions. Today, domestic ducks pose a surprising problem for conservation. The grey duck, also known as the Pacific black duck, Anas superciliosa, is native to New Guinea, Australia, New Zealand, and several Pacific islands. While its global population is considered as secure, rated as least concern by the IUCN, In New Zealand, there are serious concerns about its local population. It has been extensively hybridized by introduced mallards, threatening the genetic integrity of the species. It is now becoming increasingly rare to find a pure grey duck in New Zealand. Most individuals show a mosaic of grey duck and mallard traits. This is not unique to New Zealand. The Hawaiian duck, Anna swiviliana, now endangered, faces a similar challenge. Interbreeding with mallards has blurred the distinction between species, though there is cautious optimism. When hybrids breed with Hawaiian ducks, their offspring can regain much of the native genetic signature. In theory, this could help restore the species if managed carefully. But these cases raise difficult questions. What exactly constitutes a species? In high school biology, you were likely taught that animals which can interbreed and produce fertile offspring belong to the same species. But this is far too simplistic an explanation, and every rule has exceptions. Advances in genetics over the last 20 years have rewritten our understanding of species boundaries. Giraffes, once considered a single species, are now recognized as at least 4 and perhaps as many as 7. This becomes even more complicated when we focus in on ducks. Many species can breed with mallards and produce fertile offspring, a fact that now threatens several with extinction. So how do we define a species once its gene pool is mixed? At what point does a hybrid become a Hawaiian duck or cease to be one at all? Hybridization forces conservationists to rethink what it means to preserve biodiversity. Is the goal to protect a fixed genetic lineage, or to safeguard the ecological role and identity of a species, even if it changes? Mallards are not the only problem for conservation. Wild Muscovy ducks remain widespread in parts of Central and South America, but the conservation focus is on preventing domestic or feral ducks from interbreeding with the wild populations. If not carefully managed, this could lead to genetic swamping, where the genetic material from domesticated breeds could overwhelm and replace the unique genetic makeup of wild muscovies. So conservation efforts in these areas are focused on managing interactions between wild and domestic populations to maintain natural diversity. At the very least, domesticated muscovy ducks do not threaten other species like the mallards do, as while they can interbreed, their offspring are infertile, and so are unable to pass on their hybridized genetics. But these blurred lines between species require conservation efforts to not only involve habitat protection and hunting legislation, but in many cases careful management of introduced and feral populations, or even captive breeding or genetic monitoring. Ducks exemplify the delicate balance between adaptability and vulnerability. Their ability to thrive in diverse environments makes them resilient, but human impacts and hybridization pose ongoing challenges. In fact, their success as a domestic species is the very thing that is causing issues for many wild species worldwide. Ducks may seem ordinary, but their story reveals something far from simple. They are at once familiar neighbors, cultural icons, domesticated animals, and wild species still adapting to the pressures of a changing world. Domesticated mallards and muscovies highlight the paradox of adaptability. The same traits that make them successful alongside us can also place other ducks at risk. Together, hybridization, domestication, and shifting habitats blur the lines between what is wild and what is not. So perhaps the real challenge is not just saving ducks as we think of them today, but asking deeper questions. How do we define a species when its boundaries are fluid? What does it mean to conserve an animal whose very identity is changing? And if adaptability is both their greatest strength and their greatest threat, what role should we play in guiding their future? I hope you enjoyed this deep dive into the domestication of ducks. If this video sparked your curiosity, don't let it stop here. Share it, talk about it, and keep learning. There's still so much to discover about the world's rare and remarkable species. And the more we understand, the better our chances of protecting them. If you have more topics you would like me to cover in the future, then please drop them in the comments below. Thanks for watching!